Good morning, everybody. I hope you're all well. Thanks very much for tuning in today. I'm Paul Carberry. I'm a partner in the pensions team at Gowling. I'm joined today by my colleague, Liz Wood. I'm delighted to have two guest speakers, Alex Hutton-Mills and Dan Mindel from Cardano Advisory, and so very recently known as Lincoln. Alex and Dan will be introducing themselves in a bit more detail shortly. We're going to spend the next 45 minutes or so looking at the new pensions landscape for employers with DB pension schemes. The session lasts about an hour, so plenty of time for questions. So can I please encourage people to use the Q&A facility at the bottom of the screen? Okay, thank you. Just give you an overview of what we're going to be talking about today. Liz, just move the slide, please. Thank you. Great. Yeah, a number of sections we'd like to cover. The strengthening of the pensions regulators sanctions regime, and in particular, how corporates can protect themselves against these new criminal sanctions. The corporate transaction oversight and information gathering changes, i.e. the new notifiable events regime, new notice and statements requirements. Then quickly look at the contribution notice regime before we pass back to Alex and Dan. We'll give some practical tips about how we can protect ourselves and protect our clients. And then we wrap up with some conclusions and takeaways. Okay, thanks, Liz. So we're looking at the strengthening of the pensions regulators sanctions regime and primarily the criminal offences. You'll be aware, you know, this has been the big headline grabber, hasn't it, throughout the Pension Schemes Act development. It's always been the focus on the criminal offences. But it's worthwhile taking a step back and looking at the policy intent. You'll be aware now of the TPR mantra, clearer, quicker, tougher. And these offences are very much part of that tougher regulator. And there's two offences we want to look at today. The first, the avoidance of the employer debt. Now, if an act or failure to act results in the avoidance of a debt being paid, you can be sanctioned with a maximum 7-year prison sentence and an unlimited fine. But as well as the act being met, you need the appropriate mental element. You need to have intended your act to have the effect that it did. And this criminal sanction is supported with a civil penalty up to £1 million. The second of the two offences, conduct risking accrued scheme benefits, again, very broadly drafted. Maximum prison sentence of 7 years again, unlimited fine and civil penalty of £2 million. Again, we have a mental element, but it's slightly different than the first offence. You need to have known or ought to have known that your act would have had a material detrimental effect on the pension scheme. So to repeat, really broadly drafted, they can apply to any person. And that was subject to lots of criticism as things were progressing through Parliament. But it is clear that that was the intent. They are meant to capture a range of circumstances. But that said, I think the context there is really helpful. TPR has been at pains on numerous occasions to say that for the vast majority of people, there's nothing to worry about here. And the regulator is not looking to prosecute business as usual corporate activity. So that's helpful. That's reassuring. These new sanctions are intended to sanction unscrupulous directors and companies, which seems fair enough. But that doesn't mean the majority of corporates can just forget about these criminal sanctions. That these sanctions will have an impact on the majority of corporates in the UK with DB pension schemes, and in particular around your governance arrangements and your decision-making processes. So how can corporates protect themselves? Thanks, Liz. Okay, well, we've been through the acts themselves. So if you perform the act and then you have the required mental element behind that act, you still won't be successfully prosecuted if you can demonstrate you had a reasonable excuse. And the legal burden will be on the prosecution to prove the absence of a reasonable excuse. So it's going to be really important here for corporates to have procedures in place to ensure that they can demonstrate a reasonable excuse as part of their conduct of normal corporate activity. So how did they do that? Well, we've now had some helpful guidance from the regulator about us planning to use these criminal offences in its criminal offences policy. And what is consistent throughout and a real theme for today is the regulator will be looking for reasonable excuse to be demonstrated in a clear way from contemporaneous records, i.e. meeting minutes, correspondence, advice. So you need a robust paper trail in place to demonstrate reasonable excuse. So that's the principle, but what more detail did the policy provide to corporates that they can practically use? Well, there's three key factors that the regulator will look at when considering reasonable excuse. The first is the incidental or the fundamental test. The more incidental the detriment to the pension scheme as a result of your act, the more likely it is that your act will be deemed to be reasonable. So if the detriment to the scheme is essentially a byproduct of your corporate activity, it's likely to be deemed reasonable. So you've got through the incidental or fundamental test. But then even with that, there may be some detriment to the pension scheme. So if you're going to be behaving reasonably, you need to demonstrate that, albeit there was a detriment, you put in place an appropriate level of mitigation. So the more mitigation you put in place, the more likely it is you are to be deemed to be behaving reasonably. And in this context, the regulator has consistently said expect schemes to be treated equally with other stakeholders. And also, the earlier that the mitigation is put in place, the more likely it is deemed to be reasonable. The regulator does not want to be pursuing corporates to begrudgingly put in place the minimal level of mitigation. So that's the second of the two. The third is, well, what happens if there is no mitigation or there's inadequate mitigation? Well, you need to look at whether there's a viable alternative. If you could have got to the same place as a corporate through the viable alternative, and it wouldn't have been detrimental to the scheme, you've got quite a difficult argument to make that your behaviour is reasonable. Why do the act that is detrimental to the scheme? You have a perfectly good alternative. So that theory is fine, but the regulators helpfully set out that in some circumstances, it won't be possible to consider every conceivable viable alternative. And in particular, you're looking at a distress situation or a restructuring that needs to be done very speedily. You just haven't feasibly got the time to look at every viable alternative, but you do need to look at a range of viable alternatives before you proceed. While not one of the three key factors in the policy, it's clear from the regulator that engagement with the trustees will be part of the matrix when looking at reasonable excuse. So early engagement, full transparent engagement with the trustee before an act is likely to move you towards the reasonable end of the spectrum. If there's been no engagement with the trustee, if there's been no intent, you know, to keep them abreast of developments, then you've got a difficult case to make about why your behaviour is reasonable. And the final point I wanted to note on this slide is, what about contact with the regulator? You can't apply for clearance in respect to criminal offences, but you can apply for clearance in respect to contribution notices and the transaction as a whole. If you get clearance around the transaction and then put in place the mitigation that's being required, I think in the vast majority of cases, it's going to be very difficult to demonstrate that your behaviour was not reasonable. You had a reasonable excuse. So while it doesn't get you home in every circumstance, it's a practical step corporates can consider taking if they are looking to build a reasonable excuse defence. Okay, thanks, Liz. Okay, so bringing it back to practicalities, what can employers now do to protect their position? I think fundamentally, and this headline will come up a number of times today, pensions need to move up the agenda as part of your consideration of a range of corporate activity. Decision makers need to be aware of the new powers, and they need to inform thinking and corporate governance in reliance of that. We have the new TPR criminal sanctions policy, which is helpful as far as it goes, but as yet that policy hasn't been implemented. So corporates with their advisors need to monitor how the policy is being implemented by the regulator, and then you can react accordingly. And then the two final bullets, another theme of today, expect more management time and costs in considering pensions issues as part of day-to-day corporate activity and potentially spending more time engaging with trustees and the regulator. But absolutely key, a clear documentation of your decision-making process. So just to conclude this section, we're not expecting there to be many successful criminal prosecutions. You know, we'll be at the extreme end of things, but we do expect a change in corporate governance. Even if you can successfully defend the prosecution, you know, and you get through the process and you're not prosecuted, you just do not want to go there. It's a stressful experience, it's costly, it takes up time, and it's reputationally damaging. You want to cut this off at the pass if you possibly can. So how do you do that? Appropriate policies in place to identify when pensions might be impacted by corporate activity. Identify the impact of your action on the pension. If mitigation is required, put it in place good and early, and have a really clear paper trail about your decision-making and your processes, and why you believe that level of mitigation to be adequate. Okay, over to you, Liz. Thank you.
Thanks, Paul. On. Doesn't seem to want to move. Okay, there we go. So as Paul's mentioned, whilst the new criminal sanctions are undoubtedly headline grabbing and should be taken seriously, it's the changes to the existing notifiable events regime which have the potential to really force employers with DB schemes to actively consider the potential impact of certain corporate activities on the scheme, and to do so earlier than might previously have been the case. We already knew that the government intended to broaden the scope of the existing notifiable events regime, but what we didn't have until recently was the detail. We now have this in the form of draft regulations alongside a live DWP consultation, which runs until the end of this month. Under this new regime, which we expect to come into force in April next year, there will be an obligation on employers to firstly notify the pensions regulator of certain notifiable events at a relatively early stage. And then second, once those events are further down the tracks, employers will be required to again notify the regulator, this time including more detail as to the effects on the scheme, the mitigation considered, and details of engagement with the trustees about the event. So let's look at this in some more detail. So this slide shows the three new notifiable events planned to be introduced from next year. The first event, a decision in principle to sell a controlling interest in an employer, or the offer to acquire control of the employer where there's been no such decision in principle, is not strictly new, it's an existing event. But what has changed is the timing of the notification, because it's earlier in the decision-making process, with the trigger point being when a decision in principle has been made, rather than when a decision has been made. And we'll come on to talk about what this distinction might mean later. But the next two events on that slide are entirely new and are intended to capture transactions which have the potential to negatively impact on the employer's ability to support the scheme. So the regulator wants to know about them. So firstly, we've got the sale, the decision in principle to sell a material proportion of the business or assets of an employer. So what's materiality for these purposes? Well, it's more than 25% of the annual revenue of the employer in the case of a sale of business, or more than 25% of the gross assets of the employer in the case of a sale of assets, in both cases by reference to the company's most recent annual accounts. Importantly, there's a look back period for assessing this more than 25% threshold for this notifiable event, and that makes it slightly more complex than first appears, because this look back period requires employers to also take into account other disposals which have either been decided upon or completed in the 12 months prior to the date of the notifiable event. So for example, you might see a sale of assets on the 6th of April, 2022, which is when we think these new regulations might come into force. And that sale of assets by a company might not on its own constitute sale of more than 25% of that company's assets, but may well do so taking into account one or more sales by that same business in the preceding 12 months. So it's important to note that transactions that are already taking place may well be relevant to this new notifiable event once passed into law. It's also just noting that this look back period doesn't just take into account sales of assets or business that have actually taken place. It interestingly includes those decided upon, but not yet happened. So potentially bringing an even wider remit of transactions into the calculation. This sale of material proportion of business or assets could come up with some interesting outcomes. So you could have, for example, in a multi-employer scheme, a scenario in which you have a small group company that has to notify the sale of more than 25% of its business or assets, even when that actually has no impact on the overall employer covenant. Whereas you might have this main sponsoring employer supporting the scheme selling up to 25% of its business or assets and not required to notify here. But in any event, employers will need to consider this definition and threshold when a corporate transaction is being considered to know whether this notification requirement's been triggered. And that will also obviously need to include corporate activities in the last 12 months and not just this immediate transaction for the purposes of this reporting. The final new notifiable event is a decision in principle to grant or extend security over assets, which results in the secured creditor being ranked above the scheme in order of priority for debt recovery. And it applies in relation to an employer with a DB scheme, but also its subsidiaries. The idea being that if an insolvency event were to follow the granting or extension of security, the scheme is lower down the pecking order for payment by the company of its creditors and less likely to recover the debt than had the security not been in place. Security for these purposes includes fixed or floating charges, and the materiality threshold is more than 25% of either the employer's consolidated revenue or gross assets. Importantly, the DWP consultation document says that this event doesn't include the refinancing of an existing debt, but the draft regulations aren't entirely clear on this point. And that's something that we're responding to in the response to the consultation, because it will need to be clarified in the final form of regulations, as obviously a refinancing, particularly if it's a like-for-like basis, has the potential to bring in a much wider range of agreements than we're currently anticipating. So moving on. There's been quite a bit of interest in this decision in principle wording that's appeared in the draft regulations. And this is a new concept for the notifiable events regime. The key point to note is it brings forward to a significantly earlier point the notification requirements for these three notifiable events that we're talking about. So the regulations say a decision in principle is a decision prior to any negotiations or agreements being entered into with another party. So clearly intended to coincide with the point at which there's been a decision by an employer to go ahead, so to sell the business, to enter into a finance agreement, and before the key terms are drawn up or the contracts negotiated. But I think there are some real practical questions here around how and when this notification is triggered. How do you decide the stage at which a decision in principle is made? What constitutes the decision? How specific does that need to be? So you can imagine a scenario in which, you know, does this apply to two business owners down the pub having a conversation about a sale of business? Does it apply when an FD has picked up the phone to speak to their lender about an in principle new security? Is it something agreed in writing? Would an email suffice? So that all these questions have yet to be clarified. Another point is that the regulations don't make clear who the decision maker is for these purposes. Certainly in our experience, there are plenty of examples where the decision isn't made by the scheme sponsor, it's made higher up the food chain in a corporate structure. And in any event, can it only be someone who has the necessary corporate authority to do so? Again, these points are not clear and have yet to be clarified in any kind of regulator guidance. Hopefully we will get more clarity in due course on those. So moving on to the second part of the new notification requirements, the second stage statement must describe the impact of the transaction on the scheme and what action is being taken to mitigate any detrimental effects, including details of communications with the trustees about the event. Must be provided to the regulator with a copy to the trustees. And it's absolutely clear that the regulator wants that greater visibility on how corporate activities are being managed in practice and what types of mitigation are being offered to DB schemes. Just to flag, this second stage requirement only applies to these new notifiable events we're talking about today, not existing notifiable events under the Pensions Act 2004. Again, we've identified some potential issues around this second stage notification. In particular, how do you identify at what point the main terms have been proposed? It's potentially quite subjective, as with the decision in principle. Is this the point at which, for example, heads of terms have been agreed? Or is this the point at which the detail of, for example, an SPA are being negotiated? And who decides that the parties have reached that stage? Another point to note is that the regulations require an update to the regulator if material changes are made in relation to either the transaction or the mitigation that has been put on offer to the trustees. And again, we don't have a lot of detail about practical examples of what might be material for these purposes. But again, I think there's a real risk here that employers erring on the side of caution, both in relation to whether a decision in principle has been made for that first notification, but also for the second stage notification, that actually we might have multiple notifications going to the regulator erring on the side of caution, particularly when I note and come on to note the increased penalties that apply to corporates for failure to comply with this new regime. Final point to note here, it's not clear at the moment whether these new events are intended to apply to takeover offers for listed companies. Draft regulations and DWP guidance don't mention a takeover panel, don't mention price sensitive information. So again, it's an area that we need clarification on. So consultation ends, as I mentioned, at the end of this month. We are hoping for more clarification on a number of areas, but key takeaway is the new strength and penalties for failure to comply with the existing notifiable events regime is already now in force under the Pension Schemes Act, and that came into force on the 1st of October. And instead of what we had before that date, which was penalties for failure to comply with notifiable events of £5,000 for individuals and £50,000 for corporate, we're now looking at regulatory power to impose a financial penalty of up to £1 million for non-compliance with this regime. So it's another area where we can see this really exercising employers' minds to make sure that they get it right. And on that note, how can employers best protect their position? Well, there's a piece here around waiting for the final form regulations and accompanying guidance. I think there will also be a big piece, certainly initially, around taking advice. So what does in principle mean? When do we need to update notifications because the nature of the deal's changed materially? There are a number of areas where we can provide input. Also continued engagement with trustees. But I think absolutely key from a corporate perspective will be adopting internal governance procedures to capture these potential notifiable events triggers. So really employers getting their house in order to make sure that they can be aware of and then make sure they're notifying the regulator accordingly. So I'm now going to hand back over to Paul to just look at the new changes to the contribution notice structure.
Great, thanks Liz. Just flip on one as well, please, Liz. Thank you. Yeah, you'll be aware we already have a contribution notice regime in place. You'll be familiar with the main purpose test and the material detriment test. You'll also be aware that the regulators use the contribution notices quite sparingly to date. So the argument is, well, he hasn't needed to use the contribution notices. The mere threat of them has been sufficient. However, in the regulator's view, at times it has been difficult to use the existing contribution notice powers. So he's been looking for some additional support there. So what's the issue with the existing powers? Well, they are very employer focused. Sorry, they're very scheme focused. Okay, so the regulator's having to look at an employer act and then extrapolate the consequences of that act to how it impacts on the scheme. And evidently that can be quite challenging. So to support the main purpose and material detriment tests, we're now going to have two new tests, which I'll come on to in a moment. But the headline is these two new tests are employer focused. So they do look at the impact on the employer itself. So that allows the regulator to take a snapshot of a particular event. You know, what was the strength of the employer before the act? What was the strength of the employer immediately after the act? And that supports a quicker regulator. It can intervene more readily should it feel the need to do so. So that's where we are with the law, the two new requirements. We have a body of guidance to support it as well. We now have an updated Code 12, which sets out how the regulator anticipated using its new powers. We also have updated clearance guidance. So that's helpful as far as it goes. And so we have some practical examples about how the regulator intends to use these new powers. We don't really understand the rules of the game. Okay, Liz, can you just flip over, please? So just a very quick summary of the two new powers. The first is the employer insolvency test. So this enables the regulator to issue a contribution notice where it's of the opinion that immediately after an act or failure to act, the scheme had less assets than liabilities. And if a Section 75 employer debt had fallen due, that act or failure to act would have materially reduced the amount that could be recoverable. So we are essentially measuring an act against a hypothetical insolvency. So the act's been established, that's happened, but the regulator can only then issue a contribution notice if it believes it's reasonable to do so. And it can only do so if the individual doesn't benefit from a statutory defence. And in summary, that's having identified those detriments to the pension scheme and appropriate mitigation has been put in place. So that's the employer insolvency test. Please. And the second of the two new grounds is the employer resources test. So a regulator can issue a contribution notice where an act or failure to act reduces the value of the resources of the employer. And we'll come on to that in a moment. And that reduction was material relative to the amount of the estimated employer debt. So there's a myriad ways of measuring employer resources, and there's much debate about that, but it's been settled on the normalised profit with exceptional items and non-recurring items being excluded. Some criticism of that, the feeling is that gives the regulator a little bit too much flexibility, a little bit too much discretion, but that's where we've landed. And again, if the test is met, that's one stage, but the regulator still needs to demonstrate it's reasonable to impose a contribution notice and an individual mustn't be benefiting from a statutory defence. Okay, so that's the law again, but just a final slide before we hand over to Cardano on what this means in practice. These new powers are there. So in theory, it should be easier for the regulator to issue more contribution notices should they wish to do so. So that means employers and the directors now need to give more thought to pensions issues in more corporate activity. We flagged there the payment of dividends. Potentially that needs to be given more scrutiny before the dividend payments are made, and that's right. You can equally apply that to the granting of security, repayment of intercompany loans, disposals, restructurings. All of these things now need to have an eye on their pensions implications and whether it's appropriate to carry on as you are or whether there's scope for the regulator to get involved. Obvious question is, does that likely result in more clearance applications? I think there's an industry consensus that initially probably yes, but then longer term, whether there's going to be more clearance applications, I think will be highly dependent on how the application to handle clearance is addressed and how the clearance notice tests are applied and how the regulator is using those new powers. It may well be like the previous regime. There's a change in behaviour. Everyone understands the parameters, the activity the regulator's comfortable with, but we'll see how these things develop. So a final comment from me on this section. What can we do to protect ourselves as employers? Same message as on the previous section. Move pensions up the agenda. Fully understand the implications for your pension scheme of day-to-day corporate activity. If mitigation is required, put it in place in a timely way, but fundamentally have a really robust set of governance and decision-making procedures in place. You can demonstrate your reasonableness in your behaviour to the regulator. I was just about to hand over to Cardano, and we are saving questions till the end, but there was just one here I wouldn't mind picking up if that's okay, which I thought was quite apt. Where the UK corporate is part of a global group, and in some way down the group structure, do the directors at group level have to assess the UK pension plan implications and mitigation, or the UK corporate directors? What if the UK directors are not in the loop? And I think for me, that all goes to your corporate governance arrangements. Ideally, your parents will be aware that its restructuring may have an implication on the UK business and therefore the UK pension scheme. It will either directly engage with those implications and consider whether they're reasonable, or it'll keep the UK directors very well informed. The flip side is the UK directors are always in the loop, and they are constantly reminding their parents that activity in the UK has a pensions dynamic, and that should be built into the processes and decision-making. Okay, so that's me. I'll hand over to Dan and Alex. Thank you.
Sure. Paul, it's Alex. I mean, maybe just as you had, you'd picked up that comment, it's worth us reflecting on that as well. Sure. I suppose one of the things to bear in mind is for UK directors, where they're part of a broader group, be that a UK group or an overseas group, I don't think, because of the risk of the Criminal Act and the fact that it's broad enough to apply to any person, that it's going to be good enough to say, I didn't know. So it goes back to your point around corporate governance and really corporate benefit for whether it's a restructuring or some other corporate activity. So the lines of communication just need to be improved. And there's a slight irony in the fact that because of the way they've crafted the tests, the smaller the pension scheme in the UK in the context of a bigger group, the bigger the chance there is that you trip one of the tests because it's materiality relative to the size of the Section 75 debts. So it all goes back to, I think, the theme you're going to hear from all of us today, that pensions just needs to be higher up the agenda in terms of corporate governance to make sure that you don't accidentally trip over one or some of the tests and some of the notification requirements. Liz, would you mind perhaps slipping onto the next slide? So just quickly by way of introduction. So I'm Alex Hutton-Mills. I'm a managing director and one of the co-founders of Cardano, which was previously called Lincoln Pensions, as Paul had mentioned. I had our pensions corporate finance business and had previously been at Citigroup in their special SITS and insurance and pension structured solutions group. So I tend to play in a corporate finance and then at the sort of more stressed end, but not quite distressed, which I leave to Dan, end of corporate transactions. And I've got a pretty broad church of clients from corporate to providers of capital and also the regulator itself as an expert from time to time. So what could be caught? And I've seen there's quite a few questions that we'll pick up at the end that are picking up on some of these points. Essentially, you've got the existing arrangements in place for the existing contribution notice test around material detriment and principal purpose. Those still exist and they will continue. However, the new resources and insolvency tests effectively lower the bar because they've the regulator through the legislation has deliberately made the test, the threshold, quite low. So it's just a reduction in resources, as Paula said, that's calibrated by reference to normalized profit before tax. And then from an insolvency perspective, it's a material reduction in a hypothetical insolvency where relative to the Section 75 deficit. What's not clear is which of those tests has priority when you're looking at both at the same time. But as we've tried to capture on this slide here, it's a pretty broad church, which is just going to involve the regulator earlier and in more transactions than you might have anticipated. And you know, any list of transactions is going to be necessarily non-exhaustive. So you do have to think about something as simple as a disposal or spin-off or transfer pricing changes because of the effect that might have have on the profitability of employers, through to on the insolvency test side, refinancings, where you're either refinancing to increase the level of debt or change the level of debt with or without security, and then things like special dividends, which is value leaving the employer group, albeit there may be perfectly sensible reasons to move value up into a broader group in order to pay dividends to shareholders. So there is deliberately a pretty broad church. And I think, just to reiterate one of Paul's comments earlier, you know, whilst these tests are drafted quite widely, the regulator's been at pains to try and say that they're not trying to get in the way of business as usual. And I think, again, one of the other key aspects here is we're just going to need to develop market practice and precedent by feel, which is going to need more contemporaneous advice to make sure that directors and other parties aren't necessarily tripping up where they haven't considered the pension scheme in the context of a potential transaction at the right point in time. Liz, can we maybe move on to the next slide? So, I mean, what does that mean that we need to think about, and what are the issues? Well, the first of those is there isn't any clarity at the moment as to what materiality means. I mean, I've alluded to the fact that there's a slight irony in that if you're part of a large corporate group and you have a relatively small pension scheme, there is just mathematically a risk that any changes that you're making to either the resources or the insolvency tests will almost by definition be caught because of the relative size of the movements of the corporate transaction to the Section 75 debt. Whilst for the notifications, they've used 25%, and that's similar to the threshold for those of you that are familiar with the UK listing rules around class one tests, there isn't any real definition. So I think it's going to have to be taken on a case-by-case basis. What that then means is, because you're involving the regulator earlier, you're having to think about how much subjectivity and control might they have, where they think they have an ability to issue a contribution notice. Is it reasonable for them to do so? And again, the reasonableness based on current precedent and their current ability to think about their warning notices and contribution and their moral hazard powers. Again, they have a pretty broad church to make sure that, to try and capture something as reasonable in order to threaten to use their powers in a particular way. That all says, and that these are the next two points on the slide, that it probably makes more sense as you're planning transactions to engage early with the trustees and with the regulator, and just think carefully from a risk perspective around how to calibrate any mitigation that may be required. And that all goes into transaction planning. And I think just picking up on the last point around clearance, I think we agree that there's likely to initially be a bump in clearance applications as people are trying to feel their way to understand what are the parameters of these two additional tests. We're actually advising a European corporate at the moment that's looking at a spin-off of part of its group, and we're going through the process of submitting a clearance application. And you know, the current clearance application covers the current contribution notice powers, but we're having to run something in parallel because the new regime, whilst it's in place, the practical elements of a new clearance form haven't yet been put together. So we are having to sort of feel our way through that, and I think that's going to be consistent with with the approach that we're collectively going to have to take in the early period of the new regime. Liz, can I trouble you to move on to the next slide? So when you're thinking about tailoring mitigation and the adequacy of mitigation, I think the good news is that there's still flexibility in how you can potentially consider mitigation packages. There's clearly cash funding. There's still the availability of non-cash funding solutions. So things like contingent contribution structures, escrow arrangements. But I think we may find that the ask from trustees and the ask from the regulator probably is more around retaining value within the covenant structure, subject to other support. So I think there's going to be more engagement and more tailoring of mitigation packages once an assessment of the extent of that detriment has been considered. But I think all of that says you just need to think about these things a little bit earlier to give yourself time to plan, and also to give yourself potentially some negotiating room in any structures that you're putting together. And I think one of the other things that has become pretty normal is memoranda of understanding as a way of documenting your solution before you then move into full transaction documents. I think will be consistent with wherever we end up landing on decisions in principle, and some of the inconsistency at the moment between when is a decision in principle made and what are the terms of the deal that you've agreed, and how does that fit with or without having discussions with the regulator. So I think, you know, we're slightly in brownfield territory rather than greenfield, but I think, you know, as with most things, we will definitely, you know, through market practice, you know, help find ways through this. Might just hand over to Dan, because there are a couple of interesting case studies that that we wanted to share with you, and then hand back to Liz, perhaps.
Thank you, Alex. So again, as a brief introduction, I'm Dan Mindel. I'm a managing director at Cardano. My background is actually more in restructuring, and you'll normally find me advising stakeholders in situations where the scheme employer is stressed or distressed. But as you've heard, because of this new insolvency test that's come into play from the Act, my skill sets are now required for regular M&A activity to determine whether there's any detriment caused by painting the pre-transaction picture in hypothetical insolvency and a post thereafter. So that's me. So what we've tried to do here, we've picked a couple of case studies that we think bring to life there are a multitude of issues arising from the PSA, but some of these tend to be more common from case to case. And we've seen this month, since the law has come into force, a change in behaviour. But even before that, in the preceding months, probably through the summer in transactions, there's been a pattern of behaviour from all stakeholders, the corporates and their advisors and the regulators, to how to approach transactions in light of the new rules. So the first case study that we've picked, something that happened quite recently. So you had a large international engineering company in the defence sector that's listed in the UK, subject to a takeover from a PE-owned company in the same sector. Now, pension scheme was small in the overall context of the deal, but obviously a very significant part of it because of the new rules. And one of the key points of this deal is that you're moving from a company that was low level of debt and no security to a proposed structure where there's going to be highly leveraged and secured debt. And that piqued the regulator's interest. What you'll find is that the regulator can't be across all cases. That doesn't mean that you should ignore all the new rules, of course, but the regulator looks particularly at public interest cases, things that are high profile, particularly listed companies, and it has a real issue around PE-backed deals with high leverage. So it's exactly what you had here. So what happened actually is that the buyer, which had already been purchased itself through PE, was a very well aware of pensions issues and came with their eyes wide open, understanding the requirement to look at detriment. And I think that's probably lesson number one, which you've already heard a number of people say, come prepared and put the pension scheme on your critical path for the deal. So they came in and they acknowledged there'd be detriments and they acknowledged there was a risk of that detriment actually occurring because of the very fact that the deal would be leveraged. So the first challenge, before we even get onto the regulator aspect, is how do you actually determine what that detriment is? So how do you assess what a hypothetical insolvency might look like for a company that is nowhere near the point of insolvency? And it's very much an art rather than a science. And it's people with my experience that will be looking at it. And in this situation, I think everybody came to the table with the idea of being open and collaborative. And we had two other professional service firms look at this to try and reach a consensus of what that hypothetical insolvency might look like. And we did, we had a good debate and we came to a conclusion and that's fine. But I think what you may find, particularly when the schemes are sort of are more material in the context of the deal, or there is more sensitivity around pricing, that you may not necessarily agree in it. And we do have an ongoing case at the moment where we have a very different view of what an insolvency might look like. And we are unable to move on at the moment. So there are risks with this new law, because it's not clear cut. and it's not necessarily obvious in each case what insolvency might look like, that you can get stuck. So all the more reason to put it on the critical path. So anyway, we came to a sort of consensus between the parties here and a mitigation package that looked reasonable from everyone else, from everyone's perspective. But playing in the regulator, they are taking, certainly at the moment, more of a harder stance on how to treat detriment. And their view was that the detriment, albeit they took it sort of at face value what that detriment might be, they relied on the work of others, that detriment has to be dealt with day one. What they were looking for was not a security package and with some improved funding, which was what was on the table, but they wanted funding that automatically dealt with the detriment on day one. Now, didn't quite go there, but it did push the buyer to up their offer. Now, the question is, how sustainable is that approach? Some people might say that it's great negotiating tactics from the regulator. Some people say it's uncommercial from their perspective. You know, that depends on your point of view, but that is the line they're taking. The issue will come to the fore in situations where the scheme detriment is much larger, or there's a restructuring situation where money is tight, and being able to deal with these detriments quickly and substantially day one may not be an option. So that we see some potential hurdles, bones of contention down the line in these situations where it's not so straightforward. I don't know if Alex, you wanted to add anything to that case study.
Yeah, I mean, I guess the only other point that will need to be borne in mind is I mean, this was a public to private under the takeover code. There was a leaks announcement. And again, for those of you that are familiar with the takeover code, that starts a relatively short timetable from when the leaks announcement has been put out, and you have what they call the put up or shut up statement. So to some extent, if that announcement has come out and you then need to try and do the analysis as trustees and with the other stakeholders and agree some sort of deal in principle and notify the regulator, you're getting quite a lot of deal and timetable compression. And I'm not sure that's necessarily been fully thought about as we come to the notification requirements actually coming into force. And I think one of the questions was when that comes in. I'll leave Liz and Paul to pick that up in a little while. So there's deal compression and timetable compression. And I think as the market becomes more challenging in restructurings, again, you know, you don't necessarily have lots of time to do these things. So what we need to try and work out is how can you come up with practical solutions that will satisfy the regulator where it's got the threat of the criminal powers and the use of the contribution notices as enhanced with these two tests. And I think that's, you know, that's going to be a point that we need to deal with.
Okay, thanks. If we go on to the next one. So this one was a restructuring that took place at the end of last year, beginning of this year, but it sort of equally applies to any type of group refinance or reorganization. And again, I'll say right up front, one of the key lessons here is, again, put your pensions on the critical path, particularly in situations which are tight for time because they're, you know, particularly stressed or distressed. So in this case, what you had was a company that was in the brewing industry, obviously significantly impacted by COVID-19 and was suffering from significant cash flow problems. The company had a plan to reorganize itself. It was current at the time, the freeholder and the operator of the business. Their plan was to actually just become the landlord and get rid of the operating risk by getting in an investment grade tenant to run the pubs. So thereby firstly securing future cash flow and also improving the value of the freehold by having a better covenant from its tenant. And the idea was that once that was done, once COVID had got over and pubs were trading again, that the pubs would then be sold off and the bank would be repaid. And hopefully there'd be a rump business at the end of it that could support the pension scheme and even give some return to the shareholders. And the alternative to that was if that wasn't done, then the company was definitely facing an insolvency. Now, that to most people would seem like a good idea, a logical idea, a reasonable idea. Avoid insolvency seems to be, in most cases, the best idea. In this particular case, the pension scheme had a specific power that enabled them to block this plan through the sort of change, fundamental change of the business. But even without that power, given the Pension Schemes Act, the trustees would need to be brought to the table in these circumstances for their view. So the issue here was that partly because the company didn't realise the scheme had this power and things were on a tight timeline, they came to the trustees late, which gave the trustees significant leverage in making the deal. But also the company and its advisors were not sufficiently aware of the pensions issues. So they made assumptions, like many people would, that insolvency would be worse for everybody, including the scheme, but which wasn't quite correct. So what you had here was, because the scheme was badly funded, and because there was a risk that even this plan A of saving the company wouldn't work, and it was a significant risk, that to continue to trading might be detrimental to the scheme. The Pension Protection Fund were involved, the Pension Regulator was, of course, involved, and the Pension Protection Fund position was that, look, if you keep going and don't put any more money into the scheme for the next 2 years and it fails, the members may not see that, they will be worse off, but the Pension Protection Fund will be, and we can't countenance that without some mitigation. And the regulator was fully supportive of that. So in the end, because of the urgency, the company gave some significant, and the banks gave significant concessions to the pension scheme. So funding was improved in the transition period. And not only that, it was secured pari passu with the banks, and the scheme were given some additional security over assets that were outside of the remit of the bank security to give them confidence that they would be no worse off. So they drove a hard bargain, and the company had no choice really but to comply. So the lessons learned there are, number one, don't make assumptions about what is in the interests of the scheme. And broadening that point, it shows that taking the view of what's the best for the creditors as a whole, which is normal directors' duties, is slightly trumped actually by the new act, by saying actually you've got a special class of creditors called the pension scheme. They may not have security at the beginning, and they may not be preferential under any insolvency waterfall, but they have additional influence, and you have to take that into account when you're making your plans. So I think this could come, these sorts of scenarios could easily come into play in the next year or so, as people expect sort of a greater activity in the restructuring market. Hopefully won't impact any or many of the people in this room, but it just emphasizes the point that the new act is skewing the playing field towards the trustees and the regulators standing behind them. Alex, I don't know if you wanted to add anything to that.
Yeah, I mean, we'll pass on to Liz in a second. Maybe this is just picking up again one of the questions in the Q&A. I think one of the other takeaways to this is that the squad of advisors is going to change slightly. So where you'd probably have an investment bank or a corporate finance firm that is leading transactions and the structuring of those, and then you've got a law firm that's helping you on the company side. I think what's going to need to happen is just thinking about pensions covenant advice as part of the structuring, because those investment banks aren't necessarily going to have the capabilities and don't want the risk associated with providing that advice. And similarly, because it's sort of numbers based, then Paul and his colleagues wouldn't necessarily want to be providing that sort of advice. So there is a broadening of the advisory squad that you're going to need as you think about and certainly plan for transactions, which is something to bear in mind. Liz, is it worth handing over to you for the final slide?
Thanks, Alex. Let's see if we've got a sticky slide again. No, we're okay. Okay, so it's clear from the raft of changes introduced by the PSA 2021 that employer clients with DB schemes now need to have the scheme front and centre of their minds when they're considering corporate activities, and that's clearly been a key theme for today's webinar. And given that many of the changes, particularly the criminal offences and the change to the contribution notice requirements, are now in force, and immediate action is to make sure that directors and other decision makers are aware of the new regulatory powers and the breadth of corporate activity that's going to be of interest and is already of interest to the regulator. So we're certainly seeing within the team here an increase in interest for training sessions for senior management to ensure that they're up to speed. Second, ensuring that internal procedures and corporate governance flag up when certain corporate activities are on the cards and may fall within the scope of the new requirements. And then that builds into considering the impact on the scheme and appropriate steps, what the mitigation might be in the way that Cardano have mentioned. We're also seeing increased use of information sharing protocols, which is something the regulator is very keen on, but something that again can regulate that flow of information between employers and trustees, and is useful in terms of an immediate step that can be done even before corporate activity is immediately going to take place. Another key theme that's coming through is obviously that trustees need to be involved at an early stage. That was already the case before the Pension Schemes Act came into force. And the regulator is obviously clear that trustees should be treated as a creditor, frequently a significant one, and not just a party to be involved as an afterthought or late in the day. So employers will need to consider on a case-by-case basis whether the proposed transaction has progressed far enough to justify involving the trustees, recognising that in lots of situations there are confidentiality concerns, but nonetheless the trustees are important. What's the significance of the transaction to the scheme? What's the potential impact? Is it detrimental? And then that mitigation point. And the final piece of the jigsaw, and it's worth, you know, banging it home, but it's documenting that decision making. So how have decisions been taken? What's the advice that's been received? And looking at how the engagement with the trustees and the regulator has gone. Because as Paul mentioned right back at the beginning, that robust paper trail can demonstrate a party's legitimate intentions and the reasonableness of their actions. So that's going to be relevant to both the criminal sanctions and the contribution notice regime, but also when we're looking at a notifiable events and what the regulator is expecting to see in terms of documenting mitigation. So that concludes what we planned on talking about today. But I think we've got time now. Yeah, we've got a few minutes now to open up the webinar for questions.
Okay, thanks very much, Liz. Thanks to all the attendees. We've got an awful lot of questions today, so we'll try and work through them. Those that we don't get to, we'll follow up after the event. I'll pick one question. I think, Alex and Dan, if you want to start, but there's probably one we can all have a go at. If you're advising a corporate, what do you think the single best thing is that a corporate could do to protect themselves from these new pension risks?
At the risk of repeating what Liz and yourself and we've been saying is, I think it really is just make sure that the pension scheme is in the right place, and certainly higher up the agenda than it may have been beforehand, because the less you think about the pension scheme, because it might look like it's on a surplus on an accounting basis, and the later you leave it in your transaction planning, the more you're effectively handing negotiating leverage to the trustees and the regulator.
Thanks, Alex. I think this next one might be for you, Liz, or maybe a combination of you and me. We've been asked to clarify which of the new provisions that we discussed earlier are in force now, and which ones are coming into effect at a later date. Certainly the criminal offences and the contribution notices that I touched on are in effect now. And Liz, I don't know whether you want to just set out where we are with the notifiable events.
Yeah. So the notifiable events regime, it's the sanctions for failure to comply that are already in force. So we've got criminal sanctions for a failure to provide appropriate information to the regulator, and that includes in connection with notifiable events. That's already in force. The new civil sanctions are now in force. It's just these new three or two and a bit new notifiable events that we expect to come into force next April. And that's still a kind of watch this space, because we don't know that for sure, but we think the regulations that put all this in place will be April next year.
Okay, thanks, Liz. We've got quite a lengthy question around dividends. I won't read out the whole question, but I think that, you know, I'll try and take the themes on this, because this is quite interesting. I'll maybe throw it open to Dan and Alex to start, and Liz and I can chip in. If a scheme's reasonably well funded and is getting a steady level of contributions, to what extent does it need to be concerned about dividends being paid out of the company?
Yeah, I mean, Dan, do you want to kick off on that? I'm happy to.
Well, I mean, I don't think it's changed dramatically. I think the question said, has the TPR changed its view? I don't think so. I think, to Paul's point, where the business is profitable and the scheme's well funded and it is business as usual, pay your dividends. I think TPR, without the PSA, has expected trustees and companies to have a dividend policy already agreed about what is appropriate, when's it appropriate, and should there be mitigation for the scheme in those circumstances. So I think it supports what should already be in place, in my view.
Yeah, and I think the only additional point I'd make is where the regulator's going and what the resources test is trying to pick up is dividends are not the only way of moving value around a group. So cash pooling arrangements, transfer pricing, those sorts of things can also potentially be caught by the resources test. So you need to, you know, if the trustees are being advised properly, they'll be thinking about the broader suite of potential covenant value leakage rather than just straight dividends.
Thanks both. And I think from a trustee perspective, it's just making sure you've got, you know, good information sharing protocols in place with your employer. You get a good level of transparency, not just around dividends, about the general corporate activity that may impact on covenants. Because even if it's fine for that dividend to be paid, you know, the trustees want to be knowing about it. There's an interesting question here. Many companies will have corporate advisors already, but not all. Is there any responsibility or obligation for trustees to make the sponsor aware of the new obligations? I'll pick that one up first. Maybe others want to chip in. I would say I wouldn't suggest the trustees have a clear legal duty to do that. I would hope the vast majority of DB sponsors have now some awareness of these new changes. I would suggest trustees at least raise it with them and ask what procedures the companies are putting in place to, you know, to react to these new tests and procedures. But there's no legal duty. For me, it all goes to the points that have been discussed a little earlier. We just need a slightly more proactive relationship between sponsor and trustee. I don't know if others have got any thoughts on that before we maybe pick up another question.
Yeah. I mean, I'd only say if I was advising trustees, I'd be using this as an opportunity to re-engage with sponsors to say we should have this in place. So I think, you know, corporates should expect to receive inbounds and communications to discuss how corporates intend to deal with the new regime.
Okay. I think relatively straightforward one for you here, Liz. Does the regulator have a mandated period in which to consider the notifications you've been setting out?
Not as far as I'm aware. And I think one of the key risks, I think, as I was sort of alluding to in the slides, was just the concern around the sheer number of notifications that the regulator might get as a result of these new notification requirements. Because I think there is a risk that actually if corporates do notify as a kind of worst case scenario, let's just keep notifying, there is a risk that the regulator doesn't actually capture the events that it really ought to know about, particularly because of the concerns I was talking around, the fact that there isn't actually necessarily a connection between this more than 25% materiality threshold and actually the impact on the scheme. So at the moment where we are with the regulations means that the regulator could be just inundated with all these notifications and can't really filter them out in any kind of meaningful way. But yeah, the short answer is, certainly as far as I'm aware, there's not any particular timescales in which the regulator has to respond.
Thanks, Liz. I'm just looking at time. I think we've got one more question, so I'll just throw this one over to Cardano, if that's okay. Do we think the new Pension Schemes Act will be detrimental to UK corporates? And do you think it's going to really impact on day-to-day corporate activity?
Dad, do you want to pick that up and then to the extent you...
I think that there is a risk. It does depend. I don't want to put it on the regulator because the regulator is trying to do the job. But there is a risk if it is seen as too much of a hassle, as a blocker to deals, that we become less attractive. But having said that, having seen what's going on in the market, having seen a lot of private equity purchases of companies with DB schemes out there, the Morrisons is a prime example, but there's been quite a few more. It doesn't seem to be a deterrent at the moment. My concern is actually probably more whether it impinges on the rescue culture in an economic downturn.
Yeah, and I guess the only comment I'd make to that is, the risk is that you make pensions an additional headwind. So you've got things like the national, well, currently the Enterprise Act, and I think we're all seeing this with Meggitt and some of the other corporates that are around, which will become the National Security and Immigration Act. You've got antitrust and competition issues and making, you know, pensions more challenging potentially makes UK PLC a less attractive location for direct investment. And then as things become challenging, Dan's made the point that that it's harder from a rescue culture perspective to make the UK the sort of place to continue with business.
Thank you both. Conscious we've just got 1 minute left, so before everybody turns us off and gets on with the day, I just say thanks again for tuning in. Hope you found the session useful. There will be a feedback form coming around. Thanks again for all the questions. We didn't get to them all, but we'll follow them up. Okay. Have a good day, everyone. Thanks for your
time. Thank you very much. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.